Thank you. I did wonder a bit when Stan asked me as an speak, and think, what is this about? You know, thought, he's just trying to get me to write another paper. But at any rate, I appreciate the opportunity to talk to you a bit about the school and give you some thoughts about why it is I audit. And I see a number of you in here that I know do audit. I know that you've also been through the MATS program as well. And I know there are a number of you that I don't know that have been through the program as well and still audit too. And the reason for that is the same as any other thing that you do. As you graduate medical school and you get your MD, or you take boards and you become a cardiologist and that sort of thing, at which point I promised myself in 1976 I would never take another test. Okay? And my son told me when I finally retired, audit some classes, said, you have to take it for credit. You won't do the work. And I said, I think I will. But he's right. If I hadn't done it, I wouldn't do all the work, and I don't do all the work now. I mean, you know, I study hard and that sort of thing, but I don't inflict papers and that sort of thing on the professors anymore, generally. I know some people that do, and they're very good at it, and I commend them for it. I remember as a... I'll try to keep this fairly short, but since I'm the only one now, I've got 30 minutes. But I remember as a teenager in high school, you know, you read through the Bible two or three times and you think, I got this. And then you start thinking about it a little bit and you think, there's got to be more to it than this, though, you know. And you think, I remember thinking, you know, at night, well, as soon as I get finished with high school, and I don't have all this work to do and everything, I'm gonna really study the Bible. And 35 years later, I decided, you know what? It doesn't get any less busy than this. So if you're gonna do it, you better do it now. And I remember having a thought, since I'm much older than Jeff is, long before he said it in a class one time, you know, that it's coming to a point where there are far more many books that I have left to read than I'm going to be able to get to. Well, certainly past that point for me. But at any rate, I'm not a preacher. I am a shepherd, but I'm not a preacher. But I do have about 4 points that I will try to, again, keep fairly short about why it's important to me, and I think probably important to the rest of you, that you do things like this, that you audit. And why would you do it at a seminary instead of a local church or a small group? And certainly you need to do those things, but I think they're important reasons, particularly since it's available to us, to do that in a seminary. Now, the first point area that I would look at would be the intellectual point. when Charles Malik was addressing the opening, saving the mind. And he said, who among Christian scholars is referenced as a normative source by secular scholars on history, or philosophy, or psychology, or sociology, or politics in the university where our future leaders are trained? John Wesley's description of a pastor as a gentleman skilled in the scriptures and conversant with history, philosophy, and the science of his day. So who is it who benefits from intellectual engagement with scripture, theology, history, philosophy, and ethics, scholars, academicians, and pastors in order to address questions regarding the meaning of life, the basis of moral values, the problem of suffering and evil, and the challenge of religious pluralism? However, lay people also benefit in order to engage these similar issues, at any rate, with the culture in which they live, if the culture is to be reformed. In other words, in order to deliver informed Christian apologetics and to be capable of criticizing and refuting alternative worldviews, and to teach these things to church. It's important for me as someone that my church has asked to be a spiritual guide for them, to know these things and to impart that to them as well, because the work needs to be done by the church. There's a book, and I'm trying to remember who wrote it, that Jim Reynolds had us read. It's Don't Fire Your Church. Okay, the church is supposed to do the work. You just sort of put it out there, ideas to do and support and that sort of thing. The second area is conversation. And I was thinking about this, and I'll get to someone else who said this better than I do, as a matter of fact, but I've been thinking about it before I got to that. We need conversation. We shouldn't study alone in isolation, but it should be sharpened in conversation with others. And again, this is short, you could say much more, but just as an example, the area of biblical criticism or exegesis. The historical critical method of scriptural interpretation rose from the Enlightenment philosophies that, according to Eugene Peterson, resulted in what he says is subversion of pastoral work through the, quote, bookish work of a German scholar, talking of Julius Wellhausen, which involved a rewriting of Hebrew history such that prayer was pushed out of the action. And this was a particular concern of Peterson, since he considered prayer crucial to pastoral work. So there was a separation of the literal and spiritual aspects of Scripture and a denigration of Scripture as of divine authority. And it's been my impression in going through the school here that we're fortunate to be somewhat downstream from a very strict view of this method, which did produce, at least in my mind, confused me to a large extent, confused and shipwrecked many Bible students. But still, many of our conversation partners, commentaries and that sort of thing are from earlier times, and there are still vestiges of this extreme method present and some new methods as well. And so I think that's an example of why it is that we relative neophytes need well-informed conversation partners to negotiate these types of interpretive methods and the significant deviations that can be made to adversely affect what we believe. And as I was preparing for this talk, I came into possession of an applicable conversation partner a couple of weeks ago in the writings of a professor from a small seminary located in Austin. This writing indicates the vital importance of biblical discussion and interpretation of exegesis in community. It's clarified much of my understanding of biblical interpretation faithful to the purposes of Scripture. This writer advocates attention to the interpretation methods from church tradition, as well as appropriate historical exegetical methods in an attempt to reunite the literal with the spiritual. So we need scholarly, pastoral, fellow seminary students, church leaders, lay members, and even as I'll suggest a little later, our teen and sub-teens as conversational partners. And I might say that I would recognize Dr. Keith Stanglin as the writer of the book that I read, and you should read it. It's a wonderful book, historical biblical interpretation. Well, let's see here. Let me get down. It's the letter and spirit of biblical interpretation from the early church to modern practice, and I would urge Keith to go ahead and attempt again to teach that course that apparently didn't make this time. And I would encourage all of us to attend. That to me looks like that would be a fantastic thing to audit.
Okay. Needs a better title.
Okay. Yeah, you can change it like that. It probably would. But a third area then, which is for all people, but particularly for those who would shepherd a congregation, I think, to convey to its members is really the spiritual, moral, ethical worldview, apologetic, and polemic development of our church members themselves. In consideration, I'd just give a couple of examples there. There are many more, but just a couple of examples. In ethics, for instance, sexual ethics, social ethics, medical ethics. I mean, we're talking about abortion, even infanticide now, end-of-life issues, euthanasia, and that sort of thing. And then the burgeoning area of bioethics, particularly gene editing and that sort of thing now, for certain diseases, even editing the germline, as a matter of fact. And there's an example that I'll read to you from an editorial in the prestigious British medical journal, The Lancet, from July of this year, which says, the editor's writing, drawing on law, bioethics, sociology, medical genetics, and biology, the UK Nuffield Council of Bioethics finds that heritable genome editing interventions should be used in some situations. Further, there are no absolute ethical objections that would exclude these interventions in all circumstances for all time. Who makes those decisions? If this is the case, and they argue it is, there are moral reasons that genome editing would be permissible. And this is very interesting, the next couple of lines. People will continue to want to be parents. Furthermore, some will desire their offspring be genetically related to them. But you can alter in many ways. I mean, you know, even now they're doing things as far as mitochondrial type diseases and that sort of thing, where there are three people involved in sort of thing. At any rate, continuing here, growing knowledge of genomics, such as understanding the points or the loci contributing to general observable traits, what we look like, how we think, how our bodies are built, and that sort of thing, and specific diseases could present prospective parents with increasingly complex decisions. For example, choosing specific genetic characteristics. There are implications for psychological and social identity and the nature of a person as a free and independent human being if parents are able to pick a, quote, preferred genetic profile. Decisions by prospective parents have implications not only for their offspring, but for their offspring's offspring. These new opportunities and concerns are expected to produce a quantum shift in society's beliefs about normal reproduction and reproductive behaviors and possible abuses. For example, the inequitable concentration of genetically conditioned benefits in certain groups of families. So you could make some people much better than others and that sort of thing. So we really need Christian geneticists, scientists, ethics people to look at this and have input into those things. And there are many things even beyond this that need to be addressed. The third area, I think, is the future church, okay? Our young people problems that we're seeing in society, agnosticism, atheism, and something new, at least to me it was, in some sense, all I guess we recognize is apatheism. Apatheism was described, and there are a couple of articles that you might want to look at by Brian and Sixsmith in the Public Discourse. Apatheism is more damaging to Christianity than atheism and antitheism. And a longer paper that's more detailed on it is by Robert Pesiers, who's at Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, on apatheism, engaging the Western pantheon of spiritual indifference. He was working in England and noticed, you know, there was a Muslim fellow who was trying to pass out tracts and that sort of thing. And the guys would look at him and instantly trash them and that sort of thing. He said he watched him for a week or so, and he went up and said, "Can I buy you a cup of coffee?" And the guy said, "Sure." And so he asked him, "So you're having some difficulty with this?" And he said, "Yeah, these guys aren't interested in anything." The guy said, "Yeah, I know what you mean." He said, "Oh, are you a Christian?" He said, "Yeah." And so they just don't care. And he wrote then that there are three gods of apatheism. The god of a lack of reason to believe, in other words, science and secularism, give us all we need. the God of lack of a motivation to believe. Let somebody else worry about it. And religion is just too much drama, man. And there are two types of apatheists. The apathetic agnostics, they say it's just not worth debating whether God exists. We can't know if he exists, and if he does, he doesn't care whether we believe in him. And what's true is whatever you make true. The apathetic atheists say it's obvious God does not exist, but there's no point to the debate. We've already won, or at least we can say live and let live. So apatheism is the greatest cause of religious nuns. In other words, how do you identify, religiously? Nothing. And they're very difficult to reach, particularly secular apatheists. And to reach with reason or emotion, and there are some suggestions how you can approach these people, but it's extremely difficult because they just generally don't want to talk. We need to be concerned about our young people, particularly millennials, 18 to 33 or so. They're leaving the church. You've seen a few studies probably from 2016 and 2018. The 2016 study actually probably shows better why they're leaving. The 2018 it listed things for them to say that they were, that caused them not to want to go to church. They didn't like leaders. They didn't believe in God. They didn't like teachings. They didn't like social programs and that sort of thing. The church was the stances they were taking, that sort of thing. But they didn't allow them to say anything in their own words. And when people talked to them after that, was said, well, really none of those things were very important. And if you look at the 2016 reasons that the kids gave about it, such things as learning about evolution in college, religion is the opiate of the people, rational thought makes religion go out the window. A lack of any scientific or specific evidence of a creator. I just realized somewhere along the line I didn't really believe it. I'm doing a lot more learning, studying, and kind of making decisions myself rather than listening to someone else. Now, these answers have a character similar to that of the secular apatheists. But the 2016 Pew study results show that when young people walk away from the faith, it's more often due to some form of intellectual skepticism. They often describe religious beliefs as blind or unreasonable. They don't think anyone in the church can answer their questions or make a case. And that's some other things as far as sexuality that the kids talked about in the study that Mark Rigneris did from UT. Parents just don't spend time with their kids talking about these things. And they need to, because they don't form in themselves their reasons for abstaining, for instance. Why should I abstain? A lot of them would say, well, because it'll disappoint my parents or it'll disappoint my church, and that's their reason. That's their theology. They don't think anyone can answer their questions. But as opposed to the secular, I'm finishing. I'm working on it. I'm talking about it as fast as I can here. As opposed to the secular apatheists, they're much more open to discussion if you can address them with well-formed intellectual responses and a compelling spirituality. So we need to be aware of that. I think we need to start addressing younger people in our churches with harder subjects, ethics and that sort of thing, than what we're doing now, our junior high and high school kids for certain. And then the fourth reason, I think, to audit, and I think probably it's the same as yours, because I've met many of you and I know, I think, why you're here. And also, probably a week, Karen and I are auditing Matthew, and I remember a conversation that two of my classmates, our classmates, had just before we began, and they were talking about this. Why am I auditing, or why am I here? And I think that for me, and I think for them, I would say it's the insatiable thirst for knowledge in relation to the one who made us, that we might be among the people he created to be his people, to love and be loved, in order to do the good works he made for us to do before he created the cosmos. And I think that's why most of us continue to audit. So I would say thank yous to my professors for introducing me to biblical narratives, the Gospels and the letters, the theology of Old and New Testaments, philosophy, especially a healthy dose of religious philosophy, and a Christian ethics, and so much more. And I also appreciate their service to the church as active and exemplary members of the body of Christ. And I thank you, friends, and those that donate to the school for the critical mission of Austin Greb. It's been a tremendous blessing, and it is a tremendous blessing that we have such a treasure of theology in its proper sense so near to Central Texas. So, thank you.